Hi, I'm Mark Needham with StarTree, and in this video we're going to learn about geospatial indexing in Apache Pinot. The first thing to be aware of is that although Pinot lets you store lots of different geometry objects, only points can be indexed. And geoindexing in Pinot is based on Uber's H3 library, which is a hexagon-based hierarchical gridding system. And effectively, each point that we index gets mapped to one of these hexagons and it gets given an ID. And its neighbors in the H3 system can be approximated by a ring of hexagons. Let's have a look at an example. So here we've got a map of central London. And imagine that we've got a hexagon in the middle, so in sort of Westminster, so it's right in the center of London. So that would be like our first hexagon. If we go one level out, we get those hexagons in blue. Two would be the ones in green, and then three would be the ones in red. And if we went further, we'd obviously get four, and then five, and so on. And the size of these hexagons is controlled by a parameter called the resolution. And the higher that number is, the smaller each hexagon is going to be. Let's have a look at an example to see how all this works. So I've got a Kafka stream that contains the locations of trains sort of as they're moving around the UK. So you can see it here. So you can see we've got a train company, we've got the train ID, we've got the code for the train, we've got a timestamp of the last position where it was located, and then most importantly, we've got a lat and long saying where exactly the train is. Now what we're going to do next is ingest that into Pinot. So let's first have a look at our schema. So you can see we've got a train company, we've got a train ID, we've got the ATOC code, and then we've got the timestamp. And then notice that for point, so point is going to be our index field, we need to make sure we've got the bytes data type, and we've also put in a default null value in case, and so that's in case one of the lat or long is null, we're going to use this instead. And I've just made this a point in the Arctic somewhere, so it'll be quite obvious that this is not in London. And now for the table configs, you can see here we've got, remember, the name needs to be the same, we're indicated it's a real-time table. We've then got our field config list, so that's where the index is defined. So notice that we're saying, hey, it's going to be a H3 index, and then the resolution that we're using is 5. And if we scroll down to the bottom of this config, you can see that we are creating the point using the stpoint function with a long and a lat values, and then we're putting in a 1, and that means it's going to be treated as a geography value rather than geometry. And we need to do that if we're going to use some of the spatial functions that we'll see later on in this video. Now, because of using the default value, we need to create the schema and the table separately. So we're going to create the schema with the add schema command. So let's run that. And so that'll just take a few seconds, and then we go, it's created. And then we're going to create the table directly via the REST API. So let's call the tables command, and we'll pass in our table. And you can see we get a message back saying, hey, everything has been created. We can now check that the data is ingesting by navigating to the Pinot UI. And let's go through to the query console and click on the trains table that we can see there on our list. And you can see, like, we can see there's data coming in, and if we click the run query button again, we can see more data is coming in. Now let's learn how to use the spatial index. So it's used only in where clauses for queries for three different functions. So those are stdistance, stwithin, and stcontains. And maybe more will be added in future, but that's where we are right now. Let's start with stdistance. So the idea with stdistance is, remember, we've got our hexagons, and we're putting like a sort of a circle representing some sort of distance from a point. And what happens is that the things that fit inside that circle in terms of the hexagons, so in this case, it's those dark blue ones, those will be directly returned. So all the documents or all the rows that fit inside those hexagons, we could just return them because we know they're inside the distance. For those that are, in this case, it's in green, those ones are partial fit, what we call partial fits. And there we will apply the distance predicate and check, like, hey, I know you might be inside, but you might not. And so we kind of apply our predicate and work out whether they should be returned. And if we have a look at that in query format, so you can see this is what it looks like. So we call stdistance, we pass in the point, so that that's the point in the database, and then we pass in something representing like a point, another point, and then we're saying, hey, the distance needs to be less than 10 kilometers. So you can do less than, you can do greater than, or you can do between two values. And you can see there, I mean, if you recognize these lat longs, that is basically Westminster. So it's worked pretty well. We are within 10 kilometers off the center of Westminster. Now let's have a look at stwithin and stcontains. So again, we're going to start with our hexagons, and this time we'll draw a little shape around it. And this time the ones that are inside the shape are the two blue hexagons and we've got one green hexagon. And this time we call it fully contained if it fits inside. And then again, if we're looking for things that are inside the polygon, then we're just going to return those dark blue and dark green ones. And then for the other ones, so there's a few blue ones and a few green ones just around the edges, a little, actually even a red one, some red ones as well. And those ones are called potentially contained. And so we're going to apply the predicate on those to check whether the documents really are inside the bounds. If we are looking for things outside the polygon, so like if we said, hey, find me everything outside of Westminster, then we have a slightly different algorithm. So for that one, we say, hey, get all the documents, exclude partial and full, return the rest, and then apply the predicate on the potential ones to see whether they fit in. There's more details in the blog post that we will link to in the description. But let's have a look at some example queries of those, the stwithin function. So you can see here we call it, we pass in a point, and then we create a geometry that's representing a polygon around Westminster. And you can see the results again, those are some trains that are in Westminster. Let's flip it around and say, hey, I want to find ones that are outside that. And so you can see, like, from the results, like these trains, I guess the names of the trains is even indicating that we're probably not in London anymore with some of these. We can do the same with the contains function, but this time we've kind of flip around the order. So we put the polygon first and then the point second. But then otherwise it's reasonably similar the way that it works. And again, if we run the query, you can sort of see the result down the bottom. And so that's the end of this video in which we've learned how to work with geospatial indexes in Apache Pinot. Give it a try and let us know how you get on. I look forward to seeing you in the next video.